I guess since you started recording, do you want me to go ahead and start now? Or are we still waiting for class to end?
Billy just joined, so my whole team is here. I don't know if anyone else was planning on joining, but you can go ahead and start.
Okay. Well, thanks to bringing your whole capstone team along. So, I guess I'll just introduce myself really quickly. I am Peter. I'm an aerospace engineer. My day job is doing computational fluid dynamics on the Orion program, but I've got a side business doing drone stuff. So I've got some manufacturing capabilities, and so I'm kind of partnering with PSAS to do the ISO tanks and figure. And so I'm going to share what I know of IsoGrids. It all comes from this, primarily from a document that's the IsoGrid handbook that I'm going to kind of give a guide to. It's about 250 pages, so I'm really going to be condensing it down. I am in no means a stress expert, so if I'm saying something that doesn't make sense, feel free to point that out and just ask questions as we go along. All right, so the first thing I have on the agenda is doing the primer. And let me pull that set of charts out. I've got a link to this in the doc, so you should all be able to open it up on your own. Come on. Ah, there we go. Present. I think that's what I want. Keep accidentally closing the chat window. Okay. And everybody can see the charts.
Yep, we see the intro.
Awesome. All right, so quick intro is this. What is an isogrid? So it's a lattice of intersecting ribs forming equilateral triangles. There's a little sketch of that there, which can consist of the ribs. It can also, it can have a face sheet, but it doesn't have to have a face sheet. And it can also have flanges. And I guess this image doesn't show it, but basically on the side opposite from the face sheet, it could have flanges like an I-beam, and I'll point that out in the coming pictures. The neat characteristics about it are it's got isotropic properties, so even though you have this material that is highly non-isotropic, because of the triangles, when you want to go do an analysis of it, you can just treat it as a solid piece of material. You don't have to modeled the little details in the material. And because it's set up kind of, it's basically like making a plate into an I-beam where you've got this efficient distribution material. And so it's very efficient in both compression and bending. So that gives you a high, and when we talk efficient, we mean for rockets and aircraft. High strength to weight, high stiffness to weight. The advantages, as I've kind of mentioned, it's easier to analyze because you don't have to go and make a full finite element model, so whole thing. Or if you had some other types of structures where you had like a ortho grid or something like that, where you'd have to go do a more detailed analysis. You just kind of use the easy hand calcs to go figure out what your stresses are going to be. It can be easily reinforced for cutouts. So if you have point loads that need to be applied or wire holes that need to pass through, and then it's got a kind of a redundant load path so that if there is a failure in certain situations, obviously for what we're designing, a tank, if you get a hole in it, it's not going to magically reroute around or close up the hole, but For other types of structures, if you have a failure in one location, it will, the ribs kind of help redirect the loads around those types of damages. And the disadvantage is just that increased manufacturing complexity. Typically, the way these are manufactured is you get a plate and you go and machine every single triangle into the plate. The examples I'm going to give come from the handbook, and this handbook was developed in the early 70s. That was around the time when space shuttles first being designed and Skylab was put up in space. And so Cole basically design that was we see here is for Skylab. And if you're familiar with it all, it's basically it was a Saturn IV booster, or the Saturn IV or the Saturn V booster, and the I think what they called the stage IV is a upper stage. They converted that tank into a livable quarters. And so they just had this giant cylinder, and they needed to put some floor in there, and they used this isogrid. And here are is a picture of the dimensions with the isogrid. It was an open lattice, so it didn't have a face sheet on it. And these ribs were about 0.4 inches thick. And you kind of got some of the dimensions there on the inner radiuses for the nodes and stuff. But if you were to treat this as just a single sheet, the weight of it was would be just 0.025 inches thick. So almost like foil, the amount of mass is there. But this structure was able to withstand a 750 pound load at any point on the floor there. So it's a very strong structure, but it's a very lightweight structure. So as I mentioned, basically what I'm going to be talking out of is the IsoGrid Design Handbook, and here's the number for that document, NASA document. One thing I'm going to caution is that the examples in it, they're focused on creating the optimized design. Unfortunately, due to our manufacturing constraints for what we're going to be doing with the ISO tank, we can't get the very most optimum design. We're going to end up with a lightweight structure, but you can look at the examples to kind of get some guidance on some of the failure modes and how to go about analyzing particular geometries. But we're not necessarily going to be able to achieve those perfectly optimal designs there. And when I say optimize, like for instance, what we're going to be looking at with is cylinders and bending and axial compression, they make it so that all the failure modes happen at once. There's not like some failure mode that won't occur, or it's not going to fail in one mode and still be strong enough to withstand the other modes. There's also this finite element method repository, and there's a link to this handbook on there, but if you just Google the handbook, you can get a copy of it. And then there's a link to the LV4 ISO tank that we've already done some of the parametric design and some initial analysis. And one of the examples that we'll be going through in a little bit more detail is archived in that repo as well. So summary of the basic theory. So here's some chart of kind of the definitions of the geometry. So if you look at a single cell on the isogrid, basically what they are defining as the cell height is basically the height of this equilateral triangle. And then so the sides is 2/3 of that height, or 2/√3. The ribs, when looking from above, kind of maybe makes sense if we look at this other. Can you guys see my mouse?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So you get the face sheet, you've got the rib, and then if you were to have flanges, this is the flange geometry that wasn't in the earlier part of the talk. So this rib thickness is, or width is B. And so when you're looking from above, looking at an individual cell, this is B over 2. And then going back to this sheet, basically they treat, they're trying to dimensionalize or non-dimensionalize the problem. And so for the face sheet, they assume that you've got a section of that's a width of the cell height, and then you've got the rib depth, and then the flange width, and the flange depth. And then they, as I mentioned, they try to non-dimensionalize this and do some relevant parameters. So one of the first ones is this delta, which is the depth of the rib to the skin thickness. And then lambda is the depth of the flange to the skin thickness. One of the other ones that's going to be particularly important for what we're looking at is this alpha value, which is basically, it's the ratio of the area of the skin to the area of the rib. So if for an alpha value of 1, the area of the rib is equal to the area of the skin. And then the mu parameter, which we won't really be looking at much, is the ratio of the flange area to the skin. Any questions on this so far?
With the ribs, I mean, the flanges, is that, you still have the same machining process, or when you add the flanges, it changes how you have to make them?
Yeah, and so just to be honest, so for initial designs, we're not going to do flanges, but basically you would need an end mill that has an undercut capability to it.
Okay.
Okay, so I shouldn't say that. So I would encourage you, if you come up with a design to not have flanges, if it really makes or like really improves the design to have flanges, we can go talk about maybe incorporating that in there. It just seems like for getting our very first tank out the door, that not having the flanges is just easier to do.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So I am grossly glossing over some of this stuff here. And I encourage you, if this is something that interests you, and to dig in deeper into the handbook, especially section 2.6. And what I'm taking here is from these particular pages. But essentially, if I don't know how many of you have taken mechanics and materials, things like that, but we've got this I-beam like shape, and basically using the parallel axis theorem, you go and derive the moment of inertia of this shape with these non-dimensional values. And basically you come up with this simple looking term where the moment of inertia is this function of the skin thickness and this non-dimensional value, which I'll go over in a second, and then the alpha and mu, which are alpha was our basically a ratio of the flange area to the skin area, rib area to the skin area, and the flange area to skin area. But this beta squared term is this disgusting looking equation here. It's super complicated, and I do not fully comprehend the derivation that goes behind it, but basically involves a lot of integration and stuff there. But this is basically how you would go and figure out the moment, the calculations that you do to go and figure out the moment inertia with that. But what's nice is, we can go and make some simplifications because we don't have the flange there. And so for that unflanged geometry, the lambda is going to be zero and the mu is going to be zero. And that beta term condenses down to this, where it's just a function of the area ratios, and then that height ratio there. And then now we can use these non-dimensional values to go and figure out what the stresses are in a material. So if you're looking at, so what they define in the handbook is you've got these three different rib orientations. Usually the number one rib is in the primary stress direction. And and then the coordinates kind of that kind of go along with these rib orientations for how they're doing the math in the handbook. So X is along this primary rib coordinate, and then Y is perpendicular to that. And then we've got our unflanged ribs here. So they use in these equations what's they call an effective thickness for calculating the stress. So this is the skin thickness times this one plus alpha term. And alpha was basically the area ratios. And so you're kind of coming up with an effective thickness for that kind of represents if you took that rib material and just kind of smashed it in with the skin to figure out the stress values. And because these equations are a little weird, because we're used to thinking of like force as like a force, but really I think because they have non-dimensionalized the problem, these forces that they're defining, they're it's like force per inch or something like that. Because if you notice, if you take a force, divide it by a length, which is the T effective, that would be pounds per inch, and stress should be pounds per square inch. So that's when you're looking at the forces that they defined here, it's because they've non-dimensionalized the problem. But basically you get your stress and your X and Y, or so these are the skin stresses, I should point out. That's not going to really, how you compute that isn't going to change on the direction. And then these are the stresses in the ribs there. So if you've got a force in X and Y, this equation one will give you the stress along here. For the two and three, they're pretty similar. So if you, the NX value is actually it's a torque or shear. And so if you don't have any shear values, which is going to be like most of your loading conditions, this term goes away, and the stress in the two and three are going to be identical. But if you've got some sort of shear term in there, then that's going to change what's going to offset these two and three values. Again, grossly oversimplifying this, I just want to try to point out basically the equations you guys need to hit the ground running. And again, since I'm not an expert in stresses, I don't want to dig into all the details of the document, but if you've got questions, feel free to contact me, or like I said, I can probably guide you through the section to the right section, or you can read up on it more. There's a couple other equations of importance. So two things they go over is an equivalent thickness and equivalent Young's modulus. And these are ways of basically simplifying the figuring out the extensional and bending stiffnesses But I learned a hard way that you can't use these for stresses because there's that effective thickness term that we define here. That's what we want to use for stresses. But then this value will actually give you the wrong stress values if you try to use this in a, if you're trying, so basically with these equations, you can kind of treat treat that material as an isotropic property, and you can use these for figuring out the isotropic extensional and bending stiffnesses. But if then, like it's that if you go and use the stress, I found that I was getting the wrong values, and I was basically I thought the design was more robust than it actually was. But this, so like this will give you, it's a good equation for trying to figure out, well, if I had a solid material, like how stiff would, is it equivalent to like a solid chunk? And I'll show some examples of that later on. And then this is this, well, if I had a solid material, what would the equivalent Young's modulus be type thing? And then for figuring out the weight of, you know, I've got an isogrid with these properties, how much does it weigh per unit section? And that's a T bar value. So it's thickness times one plus three times alpha, because it's, you get the three different ribs there in each unit. I think that is most of the basic theory. Any questions on this part?
So that equivalent weight, you said it's for the three. So is that like for three of the triangles or?
Not three triangles, but it's basically, it's the one term represents the section of skin, and then the three alpha is representing the three ribs associated with that triangle. That makes any sense.
Okay.
Because it's giving you the alpha is the area ratio of the rib to the skin. And so it's trying to non-dimensionalize that weight. So basically, if you have a cylinder, you've got the area of the cylinder and you wanted to figure out how much it would weigh, as an isogrid, you would use the area of the cylinder times this T bar value to get the equivalent mass or the equivalent weight thickness.
Okay, I see. And so that, I don't know how to phrase my question, but I guess, is that including like the face sheet or plate or whatever it's called?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions?
So in the stress analysis, we basically are going to find an effective thickness and then use that thickness and treat the tank sort of like a cylinder with that thickness. Is that my understanding of it? Okay.
Yep.
And this is getting way ahead, but when we do the stress analysis, would we want to do them as pressure vessels in FEA, like an abacus or something?
If you can do the combined loading, that would, well, so I guess you kind of want to look at a couple different configurations. So one is just going to be like on the launch pad, looking at your maximum pressures. And then I guess during launch, like max Q, you'd want to analyze both an internal pressure and axial loading and also potentially a bending load. So that sounds like we're kind of getting towards, so I'll, with that, I will kind of start looking at this next section. So I'm going to look at one of the handbook examples, again, gross details of this, but in section 4.2 of the book, it covers how to design and optimize a cylindrical isogrid. And it's basically looking at three primary failure modes due to external loading. One is general instability. So I don't know how familiar you are with material failures, but if you've got a vertical column and you're squishing that column, that eventually at some point that column buckles off to the side. So that's the general instability problem. And then there's skin buckling, where if you look at the skin in the triangle, at some point as you're trying to crush that cylinder, that skin would pop out of the cell. And then the rib crippling is basically similar to the column buckling, but those ribs basically fold in on each other and fail. So those are the three types of failures that the example is basically optimizing so that all three happen at the same loading condition, which gives you your most optimized structure. And then for pressure vessels, the other thing we worry about is failure due to internal pressure. And this long story short is, from what I've looked at so far with this ISO tank configuration, the failure mode is going to be pressure. The structure is so strong that we could you know, put a couple cars on top of this tank and axially, and it'd be fine. So I'm gonna kind of touch on this, go through this, one of the examples that I've also archived in the repo, and then we'll kind of go from there. So let me exit full screen mode here. So if you haven't gotten on GitHub yet, we've got these this repo started for the ISO tank, and I'll show you the quick folder structure in here. So I've set up a README file in there, which has a link to the handbook, and then the license for the design. So LV4 is what we've got so far for the LV4 vehicle. There's a folder pathfinder here, which we haven't really populated that, but basically looking at making a little mini tank before we make the full size LV4 tank. And then this examples directory. So I'm hoping maybe as I go through the IsoGrid manual more to add more examples, but this is the example 4.3 kind of worked out. And if you feel free to add your own work examples if you want, if you're so inclined. Basically, this example starts out, it's looking at a cylinder that is 48 inches in radius. They're using aluminum for the material. This is the Young's modulus in PSI. And then they want to do an axial force of 300. So K is 1,000, so it's 300,000 pounds. They've got a bending moment of 800,000 kilopounds per inch. And it's going to have a burst. They want to have a burst pressure of 55 psi, and then the ultimate tensile strength of that material is 67 ksi. And I'm actually going to pull up, because I don't have a link open yet for the manual. So so if you're just to familiarize with the manual a little bit, it's got a short introduction, it's got basic theory, and then it's got basically all these analytical techniques for different areas. So spherical caps with under pressure, cylinders and compression and bending, that's one we're gonna be looking at. And then it's got all sorts of other ways to optimize designs for various configurations. So if you're interested in using IsoGrid for other designs, this is where to go look. So it's got a lot of resources there. So we're going to go down to section 4.2. Okay, so this is where we start here, and Zoom menus are killing me. All right, so essentially, So what they've done is they've taken IsoGrids and they've gone and tested in the failure and then figured out what these instability coefficients should be for the different failure modes there. You know what? I think I'm going to skip this because I think I need to add more information here. But essentially in this guide, I've got this broken out more in detail for the LV4 tank. So I think it'll be worth more of our time just to go through the LV4 example into doing this. But basically what they've done is, doesn't help that I am skipping around here too much. I'm just going to go over to the LV4 ISO tank and go from that example. So if under PSAT, the ISO tank and LV4 folder, there's an the LV4 ISO tank design. And basically, this is what we've documented on the design choices that we've made so far. And so looking at the, basically we're starting from a cylindrical pipe. So instead of what the other people have done in the past where they start with plate and then roll it into a tank, we're starting directly from the cylinder and machining the IsoGrid onto that. And so we've got a 12 inch tank with a 1/2 inch wall. And then we're going to, basically what we've said is because we don't have a super high confidence in the thickness of that wall, we're gonna be conservative with our machining tolerances. So we've just kind of arbitrarily chosen 5/100ths as our the minimum thickness for both the ribs and the walls. That way we don't inadvertently machine through the tank. That's kind of like our limitation. So we've kind of given some dimensions of the tank and then the material properties for 6061T6 is probably not the most high performing material, but we've chosen the 6061T6 because we can get it in the pipe sizes that we're interested in. A better material might be 7075, but that's got a higher strength but it's not as weldable, and we're looking at welding the end caps and the center seam. For base 11, we're required to have a minimum safety factor of 1.5. There's some potential advantages of going even higher with the safety factor. I believe if there's a safety factor of 4, you can actually have the tanks pressurized while people are around them. We're not going to have flanges. I think I mentioned the skin thickness is 0.5. And then the rib depth basically falls out of the skin thickness. We've got a pipe that is 1/4 inch thick. And we're looking to take that, just whatever isn't wall thickness is going to be skin thickness. Whatever isn't skin thickness is going to be rib depth. So we're just subtracting the width or the thickness of the wall minus the skin or in skin thickness, and that gives us 0.2 inches. There will be a slight change in this. I haven't incorporated this yet, but we've talked about actually shaving the ribs down slightly so that we can put a little bit of insulation over them. Pattern size for now is kind of arbitrary. So that pattern size is because we've got a cylindrical shape, we need that pattern to wrap smoothly around the whole external. And so we're just finding the circumference of the cylinder and dividing it into 24 sections for now. That was just kind of an arbitrary number that we chose. So now get into how we're kind of calculating those properties. So we've talked about alpha, which is the ratio of the areas. For this configuration, that with a rib, because we've kind of set the rib height, the rib width, and everything. So there's about, the ribs are about 12% of the skin area. So that kind of gives you that value. And then the ribs are 4 times higher than, or 4 times as deep as the skin thickness. You take those two values and then as you plug that into our beta equation, which we defined earlier, that beta value ended up being 3.5. So our initial skin thickness is this 0.5 value. Our effective thickness is 0.56. So that this tank, when you go and analyze the stresses, it's acting like that. Now, when you're looking at the bending, the equivalent bending stiffness values, it's acting like it's as thick as a piece of material that is 0.157. So it's really increasing the bending stiffnesses of the material. And then the equivalent weight thickness. So if you were just to have if you want to know how much the equivalent weight is, it's the same as a sheet that is 0.68. thick. So now getting into the load calculation. So this document also has a mass model. So this is just quickly calculating, okay, doing what I mentioned before of Katie, where we're figuring out the area and then multiplying it by that equivalent thickness. But then we're also kind of doing some funny stuff with figuring out the mass of the rings and all that. But right now the whole tank mass is about a little less than 6 kilograms. So now going to the load calculations for the isogrid part of it. So these are some values. I have to talk to Corey about what exactly these numbers are coming from. I believe it's the force is the highest axial force that we would see around max dynamic pressure. And I believe the moment is actually from a different loading condition, but I just wanted the worst case of both to be able to get an idea. And I think this moment comes from when it's coming off the launch rail and you've got a gust, and so it's wanting to tip the whole vehicle over. So those were around the worst case values. So it's about 1500 pounds or about 7,000 Newtons. And then we've got these instability coefficients from that example. And so now we're able to find out what these critical load values are. So they've got these coefficients that they've derived from testing, and then the equivalent or the Young's modulus, and then the skin thickness comes into play with this. And so the general instability, where that's the column buckling, this 12 inch diameter tube, if you were to basically try to crush it from end to end with the 7,000 Newtons, or I'm sorry, I keep mixing units on y'all. So about 1500 pounds will give you, again, I'm not a structures person, so like it's non-intuitive to me. Basically, when they're going and finding these critical values aren't depending on the loads that have been given here. These critical values are finding, essentially working backwards and going, oh, these are your maximum loads that you can take. So for this critical, so the general instability is the NCR1. That is, so it's 5.6 thousand pounds per inch, or 220,000 pounds total. So if you took this 12 inch diameter tube, you could set 220,000 pounds total on it, and it would be fine before it buckles. And then the skin buckling is a little less. And then the rib crippling, you can actually put 848,000 pounds on it before the ribs crippled. Now this is not an optimized structure, because an optimized one, all three of these would happen at the same time. But these values are so insanely large that basically what's going on is our manufacturing limitations are really what's limiting the structure, and not this loading there. So it's from one point of view, it's an inefficient structure, but we're going after manufacturability and not maximum efficiency. Now the pressure, basically we're, this one's a lot more straightforward, and I understand this a lot better. So the pressure is just, if you've got, if you're looking at the hoop stress on the tank, and you've got a certain amount of pressure inside there, it's just the ultimate tensile strength times the skin thickness, or it's basically times the equivalent skin thickness, and this that's where this value is coming in, divided by the tank radius. It's it's like you were analyzing an isotropic material, and then that falls out to be, so with our current design, it's about 404 PSI. But because of the safety factor, we divide that by 1.5. And so right now our mean expected operating pressure would be about 270 PSI. So really this equation here is going to be the limiting factor on the design. Now, we also do need to check that the rest of it is within limits, but considering that this 220,000 pounds of force is about 100 times higher than our expected loads, we were more than fine there. And then the last piece of this is the stress calc. So we're looking at the tank as a whole, but we want to make sure that both the skin and the ribs are within our expected stresses. So the force, so for these calculations, X is the hoop coordinate, which is going around circumferentially. And then Y is the longitudinal coordinate along the tank. So this, and I just pulled these out of the handbook again. So it's this, and these, again, these forces are non-dimensionalized. So so it's the pressure times the tank radius is the hoop stress or hoop force basically. And then in the other direction, it's that same thing divided by two. And there's no kind of, there's no shear associated with that. And then we're just taking the forces and divided it by the effective thickness to get the sigma values for the skin. And then we using these equations that were back in the isogrid for the three different rib directions. Again, because we don't have that shear value, two and three are going to be the same. So for the skin in the hoop direction, it's about 30,000 PSI, and then 15 axially along the cylinder. And then that primary rib is going to be, which is going to be in the hoop direction, is about 25,000 PSI. And then the other two have a lower loading at 10,000 PSI. So that is how we've done the calculations for this, for the ISO tank thus far.
So the Y direction pound force here, it would just be acting on the bulkheads basically on the end of each tank, right?
Yeah, and I guess this is not, I have not done any calculations or anything for the end caps, for the bulkheads. So this is only in the, on the cylinder itself. So at some point, need to dig into the end caps and figure out what the right equations are for that. So basically, I think we can, because we're looking to make them flat, just because it's a lot easier to manufacture. And one of the examples in the handbook should probably cover it. But or basically, it's been a while since I've had my materials class. Basically, if there's an example where you're computing the stresses, we can just substitute in the effective thicknesses for those end caps and then figure out what the stresses are.
Okay.
But yeah, the bulk of the remaining design work is the end caps.
I do have another question about the orientation of these sigma 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't quite picture what that orientation represents. In the little picture there in the upper left, the 1, 2. Yeah.
So if we go back to this, so if you're looking from above, so this would be like a sigma one going from side to side, this would be sigma two, and then this would be sigma three.
Okay. So they're not essentially of the same triangle.
It's never clear when they're looking at it, like, are we non-dimensionalized in the center of a triangle, or are we non-dimensionalizing the node? It's never really clear. But yeah, I think just the main factor is the three axes are 60 degrees off from each other.
Okay, Perfect.
Yeah. And then the rest of this Jupyter notebook is just looking at the weld strength, which is just simple stress problems where we know that, so for instance, the end caps, we know that the end cap is a certain area, you've got a pressure on it, and so you've got the total force applied to that piece. And so basically that weld needs to be able to support the force of that end cap trying to be pushed off. That force is carried over the entire weld area. So I've assumed a certain weld depth, which is 1/4 inch, and figured out the area of that weld, which is taking that weld depth and just taking it over the circumference of the inside. And then the thing is with welded aluminum, unless you go back and heat treat it at a later point, it's got reduced properties. So there's in this upper part here, I've defined the ultimate tensile strength and the ultimate shear strength of that weld for this particular filler rod, which has a reduced aluminum properties. And then just figured out, okay, with that weld area, it's a total force of 265,000 pounds. And we can have a burst pressure of 1,000 PSI, which, gives us a, safety factor of 4 compared to our mean expected operating pressure, which we calculated earlier of that 270. So that tells us that, you know, even though we're welding this, that the welds are gonna be one of the stronger components on the tank.
Can you define what the center weld is?
Oh, yes. So that kind of digs into my next piece. So
we can this, wait.
Yeah, no, no, I think it's a good time to talk about that. So we're looking to make these tanks. We're limited in how long the barrel sections can be to 40 inches. So, and we think we're going to be over 40 inches. So it's going to be taking 2 cylindrical sections, welding them together, as well as welding the end caps on it.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, so let me go through the tank manufacturing process. That was the second item on the agenda. Just, I'd like you all to be familiar with it because of, you know, the manufacturing process is basically limiting what we can do with the design. I just wanted to make you somewhat aware of that. Really the secret sauce or innovation with this is the manufacturing method and not the design itself. So as I mentioned before, that the isogrids are typically manufactured as flat plates and then formed into cylinders, and that leaves, or they usually put the pattern on the inside, but we're going to do the opposite where we have it already in the cylinder, machine it, and that means that the pattern is going to be on the outside. We're going to be using a CNC router to do this, and it's got a rotary axis on it. It's the length from the outside to the outside of the rotary axis, it is 61 inches, but the machining envelope of it is 12 inches in diameter and 40 inches long. And as far as the work holding goes, it's got this 4 or 5 inch four jaw chuck, and then this live center on the one end. So basically the pieces that we machine have to kind of work with this. And so as I mentioned, the elements to the tank are going to be the 2 end caps and then 2 cylinder sections Depending on how the MDO comes out, I don't think we'll be up to three sections, but that there's that possibility with the design there. And so assembled, basically when it's assembled, the end caps are going to be slightly recessed. And then we've got this center weld here. And then one thing I just wanted to pass on that you all can look at the pros and cons at, but there's potential that for one of the tanks, instead of having an external feed line to route the fluid from one tank from above the other tank down along the tank, there's also the potential that we could just route the feed line through the center and then kind of weld the ends there. But that's something you all can look at. So the manufacturer, oh yeah.
Yeah, just a migrance of how these work. How do you fill these tanks?
How do we build them?
No, how do we fill them? You know,
So we've got to have some sort of, you know what? I guess I really haven't thought about it too much. I guess that's really the propulsion system that we need to talk to about that. When I've been envisioning these tanks, I've just been envisioning one hole at the bottom to drain the fluid through that goes to the engine, and then a smaller hole at the top for the gas pressurant. But that's a really good question. There needs to be some sort of fill mechanism there. So that might require another hole at the top for filling. I don't know.
Okay. Well, we'll start that conversation then.
Yeah. No, good question.
And this we probably don't even need to talk about now, but I'm just curious about if we'll need to like have it cleaned on the inside before we fill them, or how any of that will work.
Yeah, I think again, Mark and JP are probably the people to talk to about that. I know they're talking about they've been talking about something that they've been talking about cleaning out to get ready. Is it the SAR test stand?
Yeah, that's the thing they're working on now.
Yeah. So I would imagine it'd be a similar process. So once this is manufactured, you'd probably flush it with isopropyl alcohol or something and then clean it out.
Okay.
But yeah, once this thing is assembled, basically you've only got the two holes for the fluids or potentially more. Now, if you guys come up with some cool design where maybe instead of welding it on the center, there's some sort of seal where we can open it up again, that could potentially be cool, but I don't know how much weight or design effort that would take. And I should also say, if you guys come up with some clever way of sealing the ends and getting rid of welds, that would be really awesome. I have not come across any cool, fancy ways of doing that is also lightweight. I mean, the NASA goes, and when they're building their, well, not just NASA, but most of the manufacturers, they go and weld all their tanks together, but they use a special friction stir welding is what they use. We'll be using TIG welding on this. But. And then the other kind of limitation is basically how we assemble all like the various steps that we need to go through. So the first step is going to be machining the end caps. And that's primarily because we're going to use the end caps to actually use the end caps as the work holding, basically. We're going to have it so that the end cap is put into the jaw of the chuck, because the chuck is only 5 inches in diameter, or able to grab something up to 5 inches in diameter, and the cylinder is 12 inches in diameter. So we need some way of mounting that cylinder in the chuck. So we're going to use the end caps. So somehow on the surface of the end cap, we need to have some sort of feature on there that the four jaw chuck can grab onto. And we also don't want that to be super heavy. So that's going to be one design constraint on the end caps. And then we need to have those holes for the fluid and gas lines. That's going to need to be coordinated with propulsion. And then one thing that I've talked to them a little bit about is how thick the material needs to be at the holes for threaded connectors. So the idea is, I guess we'll just have, when we machine it, we'll just leave bare holes there that can later be threaded. And they think the propulsion system thinks there needs to be at least about 1/2 inch thick material there to be able to do that. So then once those end caps are machined, we'll weld those inside the cylinder, and we'll test for a watertight weld before we go then and machine it. So we've got the end, because we're doing two different cylinders, we've only got support on the one end. So what I'm envisioning is machining a piece that will slide into the other end of the cylinder, and that will go to the live center, which is this little guy down at the bottom of the rotary axis there. And then once we've got that support piece on there, I don't think it's going to be actively attached to a cylinder. It's just there to the center the cylinder. At that point, then we'll machine that cylinder on the four on the rotary axis. Once the two halves are together, we'll fixture them together to make sure that they're aligned, and then do that center line weld. But because of this kind of wonky new manufacturing process, we need to kind of be cognizant of how we design the isogrid to kind of be compatible with this. And then the last comment I have that is sort of the details on the ribs. So ideally what we want is this square rib where the faces are all perpendicular with each other. If you're looking, this is looking on the cylinder along the axial direction. What we have now with the current CAD, and we'll be able to see this a little bit when Katie and Jim do the walkthrough, is it's actually trapezoidal, because the way that the extrusion process worked is it's a wrap. So there's a pattern that's defined and on a plane and then wrapped around the cylinder. And when it projects inward, it's actually making these ribs trapezoidal. And that's going to complicate the manufacturing. So if we can get the CAD to look like this, that would make things a lot easier. So I think with that, if there's any questions, or if we don't have any questions, then I think we'll move on to go into the on-shape CAD.
I just had a question real quick.
Yeah.
How are the two cylinders being joined together via TIG welding based on like their current designs? Is there like a bevel channel that the filler metal, when we TIG weld it, is going into, or?
Yeah, you know what? That's a great question. I kind of glossed over that, didn't I? In a perfect world, the reason we've kind of gone to this isogrid tank is, like, we really don't need that much thickness to hold the pressure. I think if we were to, like, super optimize this tank so that it was just a sheet, it would be, like, 1/100th of an inch, and it'd be absolutely impossible to weld. And so part of the reasoning we've gone this route is we're going to leave sections at the end of the cylinder that are the full thickness of the material where those welds are going to happen. So we're going to have a quarter inch of material there to weld to. Otherwise, if like trying to weld super thin material, we'd have to get some specialist welder to do that. So so wherever there's a weld, we're going to want to leave, not put isogrid there and leave kind of these thick areas. And as you mentioned, yeah, we'll probably want to put a nice bevel on where the welds are going to happen on the center. For the end caps, I don't think we have to worry about that because the two materials are at 90 degrees. And so we'll put a nice, trying to remember what the term for that is, that basically a fillet weld in there. But yeah, for the center weld, we'll either a bevel, a bevel would be the right way to go.
Okay, and then you said with the end caps on, it's not going to be, we aren't going to need to heat treat it, or there's something special we're doing about the weld depth that won't necessitate that, or?
I think just we've got enough weld area there that we don't need to worry about heat treating it. We could get more strength out there, but it'd mean finding a facility that has the ability to go and heat treat the tank as a whole. Which, given that we've got the extra thickness there, I don't think it's worth the cost of trying to go and do that.
So I had a list of about 11 questions, and pretty much all of them have been answered, and the rest would be for the propulsion team. But I was just kind of curious on the overall rendering of the rocket. There's two isogrid tanks. I'm assuming one is for the propellant.
Yep.
We're not concerning ourselves with that at the moment, obviously.
I think from a design perspective, we were just going to make them the same for now. If we do a feed line, we would not make them identical. I think otherwise, I don't see much difference or need for much difference between the two.
Okay, because I was curious what the ratio to oxidizer to propellant was, if it was similar or.
Yeah, that's a good question, because that, I guess that could potentially mean for a better rocket design, one tank might be a different length than the other. And I guess that comes down to what the optimization process says and also the propulsion team.
Okay. So we're going to need to coordinate with them.
Yeah. I think these have all been great questions, by the way. I'm glad you guys are thinking of these things that we haven't covered.
Cool. Also, what about surface finish?
I don't know if you've seen our current rocket. It doesn't have the greatest surface finish. I'm not too worried about it. I don't know if you guys have any experience with that or not. I think I'm just worried about not going through the material.
Well, my question applied more to where the liquid oxygen would be stored.
Okay.
'Cause that in the remedial research I've done has been the way that the liquid oxygen interacts with the aluminum can mm-hmm. sometimes requires the use of anodization. So I was just kind of curious if that was being considered.
Okay, I was not aware that it required anodization. I guess we need to figure that out real soon if that is a requirement. I don't think it is, but be good to know.
I'll look into it some more. Yeah.
I don't know if you know Mark Wasserman. He's done a lot of research into I think material compatibility, but he's on the PSAS Slack.
Well, I will reach out to him.
Yeah. Katie or Jim, do you all want to pull up the CAD?
Yeah, I can pull it up.
I'll stop sharing here.
And Billy, I want to say also, I go to the propulsion meetings on Tuesdays. So if you have questions and you don't get some answers, you can send me your questions and I can ask them at that meeting as well.
Well, what time is it on Tuesday?
Right now it is at 3 p.m. but I think it's going to be changing.
Yeah, and I'll see if I can get a time for all of us to meet with like all the propulsion everybody, just to help talk through some of the questions.
I'm in FEA during that time.
Yeah, we're going to be changing that time too, but I think it'd be good for all of us to get together anyway.
Yeah, we'll find a time. Okay, so, and Jim, feel free to jump in. And Billy, I don't know how much you saw, if you want to talk about any of this too, but this is the current IsoGrid CAD that's an on shape. And yeah, I mean, Billy or Jim, do you guys want to say anything?
Well, yeah, I've been digging into this, trying to get it to work in SolidWorks. But I mean, I don't know if it's a consequence of the wrap function, but this thing ain't round.
Oh, that's news to us.
Is it actually not round, or is it just CAD?
What do you mean by that?
Well, are you not seeing what I'm seeing?
Oh, you're seeing the basically the way it renders is it's like a polygon. It's faceted.
Yeah, and I don't know if that's a consequence of the wrap and the pattern staying flat as it wraps around.
Yeah, I think it's more of a rendering thing than a.
Yeah, I think because it's a you know, it's an online CAD program, they probably try to find ways to reduce the bandwidth, and that might be one of the ways.
It well, because it showed up like that in SolidWorks as well.
Oh.
It might also be rendering, but we could look into that.
And well, the other thing too is that that Peter brought up about when it's wrapped, the rib becomes trapezoidal. And my question is, I looked into it, and I couldn't really get any good answers about how to do that pattern in CAD onto a cylinder.
Mm-hmm.
But given the shortcomings of using a wrap, I'm wondering if there's a better option.
So I've done some research into it. I've got another CAD package of my own, and there's no easy answer, is what I found so far. I think the one approach that I found is instead of trying to like extrude from the inside out is basically basically start with a cylinder with just the skin and then add a rib and basically like extrude the rib helically around the cylinder. And then yeah, like you'd have to do that like three times, like almost like a screw thread. And then you have to do it in the two other directions. Like one of the directions is easy because it's circumferential around it. And I don't know if it makes more sense to, I don't know how SolidWorks does, but I don't know if it's just, if you can make like one row and then like basically copy the feature of that row down or not.
I think that's possible.
Yeah, so I think what we could try is a helical patterns in a circular pattern and then linearly across the cylinder for the circumferential patterns.
I like that idea.
Cool. Could we also, I don't know, it's probably no, but could we just do like a really thick sheet metal part in SolidWorks and then just bend it into a cylinder and model it that way? Or would that be bad?
I don't know how that would. So basically, once you all have the CAD, in order to take it to the machine, so there's a CAM software that I have that basically I take a STL file and then convert that. So as long as it still has the non-trapezoidal, it should be okay. But I don't know how it handles the sheet metal being physically formed into a cylinder, if that would also make the ribs trapezoidal.
Okay. Okay, well, since we're gonna be changing it, then a lot of this probably isn't super useful, but basically JP had gone through and set up some basically parameters, which we can do in SolidWorks too. So the initial properties, just as like variables, and then the independent variables, so that we can go in, and we'll do it in SolidWorks too, but we can go in just how we would with like the calculations and put in like what we want for skin thickness, and then it will automatically output this pattern, if that makes sense. So that way we're not having to like model it differently each time. It will just automatically update it when we change the variables. So.
And then one other thing I've kind of also forgotten about. So I don't know if how familiar you all are with the module rings. So this is just something, the rings that have been scaled up from the LV3 design. I think it's built on the wall thickness being 3/8 of an inch thick. For our iso tank design as it is right now, we're looking at using 1/4 inch material, but that may not be compatible with the ring system, or like, I don't know if it's possible to make this ring design shrunken down to 1/4 of an inch. So that's something else that needs to be looked at.
So the rings for LV4, that what you're saying is that they haven't been scaled up yet in design,
or they basically it's just a crude approximation, because they've just, all we've done is just scaled it, and basically they might need to be redesigned for the current size.
Okay.
Yeah. And if it was the design that was compatible with 1/4 inch wall instead of 3/8, that would be helpful for reducing the weight of the tank. We can get, so I think right now we can get the tank material in half or in 1/4 inch, 3/8 inch, and 1/2 inch thick walls, basically. But really, we don't need that much material. So anything over 1/4 inch starts adding unnecessary weight.
And I imagine that the method by which the end caps to be welded and how they'll interact with the those rings is yet to be determined.
Not entirely. I mean, basically, what we've been envisioning is the end caps will be recessed to, so this, the point on there where there's that like extra thickness below the rings, that's where we want to weld onto. And so as long as the end caps are kind of recessed there so that we can put that fillet weld where that extra thickness part is, then yeah. But the details on that need to be done.
And one of my initial questions was about internal or external machining, and it seems like we're pretty committed to external.
Yeah, I don't even know if. I mean, other than doing it on a flat plate and wrapping it, I'm not quite sure how you'd even do internal. We talked to a machining center about doing just this design on the outside, and it was crazy expensive. So I don't even know how much more expensive the internal machining would be.
So I imagine that the you were talking about in the ISO grid ribs being recessed somewhat so that we could cover it with something.
Yeah.
And that was also another question, which might be more for propulsion as well, but to what degree would it need to be insulated?
Hey, Billy, if you're looking at the notes, if you go back a few meetings ago, he's got a couple conceptual images of that that Peter put together, just if you want to visualize what he's talking about with the insulation. Yeah, there.
I think we decided on concept two. Unless we can't make the rings work with quarter inch, then we might have to go with concept three. But yeah, basically the idea behind there is if you're sitting on a launch pad, you've got that thing full of liquid oxygen. I forget what the temperature is, but it's pretty darn cold. And just the it's going to freeze any residual moisture in the air surrounding it and cause ice buildup on the outside. So the insulation is to try to prevent that.
Can you walk me through the orientation of these images?
So this is kind of looking, so these are slices, I guess, so from side to side on the page is kind of axially along the vehicle there. So you've got these are circumferential ribs that are showing here. And then this cross section is the, so if you look at this is the tank wall and this, the I'm lighter
seeing,
gray.
I'm not seeing your mouse move.
Oh, yes, because I'm not sharing.
Oh. Okay.
I forgot that I was not sharing. Yeah, so on the concept two where the pointer is, that's kind of the cylinder wall of the tank. And then you've got the dashed line is the interface between the one module and the next module. And the darker gray are the basically clamps that clamp onto the ring there.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, so on the left, I see the flush and the short ribs, and then to the right, what does that represent?
That is the composite modules there. So the orange is the Nomex filler, and then the black on either side is the carbon fiber phase sheets.
So those are the non-isogrid modules, really.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Cool. So any final questions or thoughts? Andrew's on now to talk to us about non-isogrid stuff. So
yeah, so if you all have any questions, I think Katie has my contact info, and I am more than happy to help out and then coordinate with y'all as we build the ISO tanks.
In particular, I'd like to really encourage you guys to abuse Peter as much as possible. I think that he's good and he is around and he knows this stuff and he can guide you guys to go fast, 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 which is what we want and what we're about to talk about.
And he's Thank on you. The PSAS Slack too.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, thanks, Peter. That was great.
Yeah. No, thank you all for coming in and listening to me ramble for an hour and a half.
That was fantastic. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Pleasure.